Dear students, recall the last class what I studied. We have studied something about the different types of vaccines, the live vaccines coming and what we have attenuated recombinant vaccines or DNA vaccines, etc. So under the DNA vaccines we have different types, just like the different mechanisms adapted. We also studied recombinant subunit vaccines. Now one such subunit vaccine is hepatitis B vaccine. One such subunit vaccine, one of the examples for subunit vaccine, hepatitis B vaccine. As I mentioned earlier, in the case of subunit vaccine, not the entire organism is used, only a part, a component of that organism is used. Either the peptide or the protein, or we have the DNAs of the organism. Now here, the production of recombinant vaccine, that is HB vaccine, how is it produced? The mechanism would be the same as in the case of insulin hormone, no change. Except that the source of gene, in the case of human insulin hormone production, the recombinant technology requires a gene from the pancreatic cells. But here, the gene is isolated from the virus, the one which causes hepatitis. So we have different types of hepatitis virus, hepatitis B virus, A virus, we have non-hepatitis A virus, like that hepatitis C, etc. So the only difference is, instead of using the pancreatic source for the gene of interest, here we are using what's called hepatitis B virus because the gene is present in that only. Hepatitis, actually the gene. Now it contains the gene, the hepatitis B virus, and that DNA has been taken out containing the gene, and by using that gene we can produce antigens. That is the mechanism. I mentioned already it is an example for subunit vaccine. So recombinant HB vaccine is a subunit vaccine. How is it produced? It is produced by cloning of hepatitis B surface antigen. And the surface antigen here referring to what is the outer protein coat. So it is normally just produced by cloning a hepatitis B surface antigen gene. That protein is being produced by a gene present in the DNA. So here only the component, namely the protein component, the outer coat, is normally causing the disease, and by using that one we can produce what is called a vaccine. So it is produced by cloning of hepatitis B surface antigen gene, normally called HBsAg. Sometimes it is also called Australian antigen. It is also called Australian antigen, the gene for Australian antigen. From an apparently carrier individual, we can get the antigen also. Now here, another difference between the insulin production and then hepatitis B vaccine production. There we are using the host cells, the E. coli bacterium. Here we are producing the host cells, the yeast Saccharomyces cerevisiae. So in the case of interferons also we are using, you know, that one Saccharomyces cerevisiae. Like that here we are using what is called the yeast, not the E. coli bacterium, as in the case of human insulin production hormone. Okay. Now normally, you see what we are doing. So we are getting the gene, what is called the hepatitis B, that is HB antigen producing gene. Hepatitis B antigen producing gene that is being isolated from the hepatitis B virus. That is a source, the gene of interest. Then we have the bacterium. So plasmid is absent in the case of, for example, yeast. So we are getting the plasmid, the vector first from the bacterium. Now this is the bacterial DNA. We have the bacterium, the plasmid DNA. Now we need the source of plasmid from the bacterium. But you see that one, the cloning occurs only in the yeast cell. We are getting what is called actually the plasmid from the bacterium. The cloning of genes, we need the host cells, namely Saccharomyces cerevisiae. Now the plasmid DNA is taken out from what is called the bacterial cell. The plasmid DNA is cut with the restriction enzyme, ECOR enzyme, to open that one. Okay, and it is made to recombine with what is called the gene that is taken from the hepatitis B virus. That process is called recombination process. The opening is with the help of, you know, that one restriction endonuclease. and the joining of the source of gene or the gene of interest with the plasmid is affected by the DNA ligase. As a result, we are getting also the recombinant DNA having a plasmid DNA with the gene of interest. Now, it is being incorporated into the yeast. Now, the yeast is having its own gene, and also we have the plasmid. Normal plasmid is normally absent. We are introducing what we have the plasmid into this yeast cell. Then now the yeast cell starts producing what we have, that is the antigen. For massive production of that antigen, we are using what is called the fermentation tank or the fermenter to get mass production of what is called HB antigen. So now these cells are actually introduced in the fermented tank. So the recombinant yeast cell multiply and produce HB antigen in fermentation tank in large mass. That is being expressed. Now these are the products of HB antigen. So it is being collected. So after processing, after purification, extraction and purification, as in the case of insulin hormone being done, and then it is being stored. This is a HB vaccine. Now, the recombinant vaccine for hepatitis, this is the production, the same method what we adapted as in the case of human insulin hormone, but the source of the gene is from the virus and the host cell is a yeast. That's the only difference. There we have the pancreatic cells and the bacteria. But the plasmid is applied only from the bacterium, but the host cell is nothing but the yeast. Remember that one. Now, the recombinant vaccine for hepatitis B, that is HBsAg, was the first synthetic vaccine, what is called the recombinant vaccine, launched in 1997, which is normally, so at the, during that year, it was marketed under the trade names, what is called Recombivax and Engerix B. These are the trade names of what is called the vaccine, the recombinant hepatitis B vaccine, that was marketed in 1997. The names are Recombivax and then Engerix B. And India is one of the four countries in the world, actually, after UK, sorry, I made a mistake, after USA, then Belgium and France, to develop indigenous hepatitis B vaccine. India is the fourth country in the world after USA, France and Belgium to develop indigenous. That is what is called actually being synthesis in India only. Just like for making COVID vaccine for the virus for COVID, we are just synthesizing the vaccine. If it is synthesized in India, then it's called indigenous vaccine. So India was actually the fourth country, that is during that era, develop indigenous vaccine along with USA, then France and Belgium. That's about the, what is called the production of recombinant vaccine. That also about under the heading applications of biotechnology and medicines, the different ones, the interferons, the vaccines. We have just other medicines what we prepared, the human insulin hormone, etc. Now we have to go for actually another aspect of application of biotechnology, that is gene therapy. That's the next one. As I mentioned earlier, India is the fourth country in the world after USA, France and Belgium to develop indigenous hepatitis B vaccine. The vaccine which is being prepared by India, that's called indigenous vaccine. So we have studied so far, the first one, what we have the applications of biotechnology in medicine, that part is over. We have to go to the next part, that is applications of biotechnology, what is called the gene therapy. If you have the word therapy, therapy means treatment. So gene therapy involves the replacement of defective genes with corrective genes. That process called actually, suppose the human insulin gene is defective, that gene has been replaced by a normal functioning gene. So the replacement of defective genes with the corrective genes is called gene therapy, treatment through replacement. Now, this process involves the transfer of genes into the cells, what I mentioned, of a person. And that cell carries one or more mutant alleles of the genes. One or more mutant alleles of the genes. That's why I said, a cell with a defective gene. And that gene has been replaced. And that process is called gene therapy. Now, normally, if you take any gene, the expression of a normal gene, normally in a person produces a functional gene product whose action produces a phenotype. The expression is only in the form of a phenotype. That's normally happening. But here, because of mutation, that gene, the product will not be produced, so the phenotype will be affected. Now, for the transfer of genes, we need some vector. The possible vector that is normally used in the transfer of genes in the case of human beings is a retrovirus. So, gene therapy is accomplished by using a vector, the possible, the most suitable vector, retrovirus. Sometimes adenoviruses also. In the retrovirus, you know that one, just like AIDS virus, it undergoes reverse transcription process, hence the name retrovirus. So, the vector for gene transfer in gene therapy is retrovirus. It is a harmful one. So, certain genes are being spliced out. The harmful genes are spliced out from this possible virus, making the virus normally harmless and best suitable for the transfer of genes. So, the retrovirus is used as a vector. What is the main thrust or aim of gene therapy? It has been directed at correcting single gene mutations. The main purpose is normally to correct single gene mutations. That's the aim that is directed towards. Correcting single gene mutations. We have a number of single gene mutations. For example, two diseases given here, but we have many diseases. Hemophilia is caused by a sex-linked recessive gene. So that gene has to be replaced with the help of this one. That's the main aim of what is called the main thrust or aim of gene therapy. Another disease, cystic fibrosis. It is an autosomal recessive gene disorder. A single gene mutation. There also a single gene mutation that results in hemophilia. And here also we have single gene, autosomal gene. And that one is sex-linked gene. So if there is any single mutation in a single gene, that can be corrected with the help of what is called gene therapy. But it is applicable only for just correcting single gene mutations, but not applicable for multiple mutations. So there is a main aim and the thrust of gene therapy to correct single gene mutations which cause diseases. Okay, now let's go further. Now at present, most of the genetic defects have no effective treatment, and so this gene therapy offers hope for many people. Now what are the strategies adapted in gene therapy? There are two strategies adapted in gene therapy. Number one, gene augmentation. Number two, gene inhibition. Augmentation means stimulation. Inhibition means suppression. So the first process, gene augmentation, it involves the insertion of your DNA into the gene. Into the genome, not the gene, into the genome. That is a whole genetic material into the genome. That replaces missing gene product. The missing gene product has been normally replaced. Because you see that one, it's already absent that gene, so that there's no production of that particular product. And here we are inserting the gene that replaces the missing gene product, so that now the cells can produce a specific protein. Now the second one, gene inhibition. Some genes are harmful. Here the gene is absent, that's why we are adapting gene augmentation. But here we see that one gene is harmful. It is there inhibiting some activities of metabolism. So this process involves the insertion of antisense gene. This is one of the mechanisms adapted to suppress the activity of either mRNA or the gene, etc. So it involves the insertion of antisense gene, the one which is working against the harmful gene present in the body. That inhibits the expression of what we call the dominant gene. So the dominant gene expression is normally suppressed or inhibited by just inserting antisense gene. These are the two strategies. Now we have to go for the two approaches in gene therapy. One, somatic cell gene therapy, The second one, germline gene therapy. Okay, we'll discuss. We have seen the two, what we have, the strategies. We can say the gene augmentation and also gene inhibition. Now, what are the two approaches normally to achieve gene therapy? So, there are two approaches to achieve gene therapy. One is somatic cell gene therapy. Here, the somatic cells are used into which the gene is inserted. The second one, germline gene therapy. It is called germline because there is a continuity of life because of the germ cells like egg and sperm. They represent the continuity of life. So germline gene therapy involves a transfer of genes into the germ cells like sperm and egg. So number one, somatic cell gene therapy. So it involves normally the insertion of more functional and then expressional, actually we can say expressible genes, instead of writing in this way, expressible genes. Expressible genes into target somatic cells. I mentioned already we are using only the somatic cells. Somatic cells to correct genetic defects permanently. But the somatic cells are, you know that one, not a germinal cells. Once the corrections are made, they are not being transmitted to the next generation. They are actually confined to only the present generation, not being transferred to the next generation. That's why it's of no use mostly. Now the next one, germline gene therapy. It involves the introduction of DNA, the gene of interest, into the germ cells, what we have, which is passed on to the next generation. If there is any defect in the germplasm, either the sperm or egg, that can be corrected through what is called germline gene therapy. As these cells are responsible for transferring the characters to the next generation, along with that one, the correction that has been made also transferred to the next generation. So that's about somatic cell gene therapy and germline gene therapy. Now let's compare. What are the differences between somatic and then what we have, the germline gene therapy? Just in a nutshell, we'll see. What are the differences between somatic cell and germline gene therapy? As the name implies, you know that one, the therapeutic genes, the medical genes or the medicinal genes, or transferred to the somatic cells here. Where here the genes of interest which are used for making medicine, the therapeutic genes, are transferred to germ cells like sperm and egg. So what are the cells involved? So introduced genes, this method introduced genes into blood cells, somatic cells, the bone marrow cells, hair cells, etc. Whereas here, introduction of genes into egg and sperm, these are all the germinal cells. Now I mentioned here the somatic cell gene therapy after genetic engineering, it is not being transmittable because the somatic cell is not a sex cell. So will not be inherited in later generation, will not be transmitted to the next generation because we are doing the genetic engineering process only in the case of somatic cell. It is a non-reproductive cell. Unlike this one, in the case of germline gene therapy, then now once incorporated through genetic engineering method, such characters are heritable and passed on the later generations. Because they are doing it in the case of germ cells, they are taking part in the continuity of life, so they are being transmitted to the next generation. These are all the differences between somatic cell gene therapy and germline gene therapy. Now, what are the steps involved in gene therapy? Very simple steps. Number one, isolation of specific gene. We can say the gene what we needed for the production. For suppose a particular gene is absent, an ADA gene is absent, that gene or the ADA gene is non-functional, it is being replaced. So for that we need a gene, a normal gene, to replace the defective gene. First one, isolation from a normal cell. Then making its copies, because it's only one gene is enough to produce the effect. So we need more copies, so that's called amplification of genes or gene cloning, production of making copies or production of many copies of what we have, that gene, that's called cloning or amplification. And finally we need a host cell for the multiplication of that genetically engineered gene. So inserting them into the target cells to produce what we have, the desired protein. So the desired protein is nothing but the enzyme. That enzyme is coded by a gene. If the gene is defective, the enzyme will not be produced. That will affect the metabolism. So once the gene has been replaced by a normal gene, now a normal enzyme is produced to conduct or to perform the metabolic activity. That's the last one. Inserting them into target cells, the cell where we have actually defect, and to produce what is called the desired protein. Okay. What are the limitations or criteria to be followed while doing gene therapy? See, it is absolutely essential for the gene therapist just actually to ensure that, number one, the gene is harmless to the patient. Once it is incorporated, once the defective gene is replaced by the corrective gene should not disturb the patient. So it should be normally harmless. Then it is appropriately expressed. We have to note that one, whether the gene is appropriately expressed or not. Simply inserting the gene, not waiting for the expression, it is not actually that is useful, the process. So, and then the last one, whether the immune system affect the new protein synthesis by the new genes or not. So, the immune system does not react to the foreign proteins, because now the foreign protein as it is produced by the new gene, hence called foreign proteins, synthesized by the new genes. Okay, so the immune system does not react to the foreign proteins synthesized by the new genes. These are all what we have the limitations or the precautions to be taken while we are doing the process of gene therapy. Okay, so this is about gene therapy. We have to go for how far one disease. SID. There is a disease what's called SID. How it can be cured by means of gene therapy, we'll see in the next class.